88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248 to BR in Santa Cruz, and online at kpfa.org. The time is 2 p.m. Stay tuned next for About Health.
Good afternoon and welcome to About Health. I'm Dr. Will Courtenay, the men's doc, psychotherapist in Oakland, and your host. What's the first thing you think of when it's time to get screened for colon cancer? If you're like most people, it's feelings of dread that come to mind. And not just about the screening, it's the preparation, swallowing gallons of a vile and disgusting drink that then keeps you glued to the toilet all day. And then there's the screening itself, getting a tube stuck in your bottom, which is then sent seemingly endlessly up through your insides. Well, that's just about enough to make a lot of people not get screened for colon cancer, especially the fear of discomfort. In fact, having heard that the test may be painful or difficult is a leading reason why people don't get screened. And that's a problem. Colorectal cancer is the second leading cause of death in men and the third leading cause in women. Each year, more than 50,000 people die from it. But despite this, nearly one in three people who should be screened for colon cancer aren't getting screened. And it's the people at risk, like men and African Americans, who are among the least likely to be screened. Screening for colon cancer is critical because people often don't experience symptoms when they have the disease, and with screening, it can be prevented. Now, the barriers to people getting screened are often concerns about colonoscopies. But the fact is, colonoscopy is only one of several effective screening tests for colon cancer. But many people remain completely unaware that non-invasive stool tests are available, and that these tests are effective in identifying cancer and even small growths called polyps that can turn into cancer. And these tests have none of the risks and complications or discomfort that can occur with colonoscopies. March is National Colon Cancer Awareness Month. So today on About Health, we're going to be talking about colon cancer, how common it is, who's at risk, preventive screening methods, and overcoming barriers to getting screened. Joining me in studio to discuss these topics are two physicians from UCSF, the University of California, San Francisco. They're also both associated with the San Francisco Cancer Initiative, or SFCAN, a new initiative to reduce the city's cancer burden and cancer disparities. Dr. Robert Hiatt is a professor of epidemiology and biostatistics at UCSF and also the associate director of the UCSF Helen Diller Family Comprehensive Cancer Center. Dr. Hiatt is co-leader of SFCAN. He's also an adjunct professor in the Division of Epidemiology at UC Berkeley and an adjunct investigator in the Division of Research at Kaiser Permanente in Oakland. Welcome to About Health, Dr. Hiatt.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
I'm glad to have you with us. Also joining us in studio is Dr. Michael Potter. Dr. Potter is a professor in the Department of Family and Community Medicine at UCSF, where he sees patients and conducts research. Dr. Potter co-leads the Colorectal Cancer Task Force for SFCAN. He also co-chairs a committee of the National Colorectal Cancer Roundtable, which is promoting the goal of getting 80% of eligible Americans up to date with colorectal cancer screening by the end of 2018. Dr. Potter, welcome to About Health.
Thank you.
So, Dr. Hiatt, I think I'd like to begin with you as the co-leader of SFCAN. Perhaps you could just start broadly. SFCAN is an initiative that addresses cancer in general. So maybe you can just start by telling us a little bit about the initiative, who's involved, and there are lots of players.
Sure. Happy to do that. Thank you for having us on the program to discuss this. One of the things we are concerned about in cancer research is cancer prevention, of course. We think a lot of progress can be made by focusing on ways of preventing cancer in the first place. We've looked at this fairly carefully over the years, and we know that just five cancers account for almost 50% of deaths from cancer. Mm-hmm. And these five cancers in our area are colorectal cancer, lung cancer, breast, prostate, and liver cancer. We know something to do about each one of these, and there are programs throughout the region and actually nationally to attack them individually. What we're trying to do with SF Can is systematically approach them all together and pull together all the entities within the city that are concerned about cancer to work together to have a collective impact on cancer overall.
And what are some of those organizations and agencies? And so from the mayor's office down,
yes, right? We've partnered with everybody we can pull into the team, starting with the mayor and the Department of Public Health, but also with Kaiser and the Hospital Council, which includes all the other hospital systems, the American Cancer Society, the San Francisco Clinic Consortium, which is the safety net clinics that Mike's working with currently, and other groups from the community who are concerned about the health of their residents and citizens. So it's a pretty broad coalition, and one which we think is fairly unique around the country, dealing with the topic of cancer prevention and early detection.
And what are the stated goals?
Stated goals are to reduce the cancer burden in the city and county of San Francisco to a point where we may be the, or that county, San Francisco County, would be the, have the best record across the state of all counties in terms of the cancer burden. This will be a long-term affair. You can't change cancer rates overnight, and we have to commit to being in it for the long haul, which we have. So this may take 10 or 15 years before we really see some real benefit across the population. Meanwhile, we'll be making a difference, we think, with individuals and
in the short term.
In the short term.
Uh-huh. So, and I know one of the other stated missions is to address disparities in cancer, so I'm sure we'll want to get to that today as well. So thanks for that overview, Dr. Hiatt. And Dr. Potter, let's focus now on colorectal cancer, and you are tasked at SF Can with addressing that in particular. Maybe you can just give us some paint a picture of who we're talking about here, and in terms of the Bay Area, who's getting the cancer, who's dying from it, who's getting screened, who isn't. Can you tell us about that?
Sure. Yeah, colorectal cancer affects people increasingly as they get older. So the target group that we're talking about trying to make a difference with is people between the ages of 50 and 75. That's the age group when people tend to get colorectal cancer and tend to be able to be at a stage where they can benefit from screening the most. So actually, we've made a lot of progress in screening and in colorectal cancer prevention in the last decade. Nationally, the incidence of colorectal cancer has actually declined by about a third, due in large part to screening and removing these polyps and before they become cancers. In addition, mortality has dropped by about a third, also probably in large part due to screening, which detects cancers early when they can be removed and cured.
Uh-huh. So who is getting screened here in the Bay Area, and who isn't? Who do we need to focus on or try to target?
Right. So largely, people who have primary care, who go to see their doctor regularly, uh-huh. are very likely to get the recommendation for screening. If you are in a health system that can provide a variety of options for colorectal cancer screening and can offer them all, you're likely to complete one. That means either a stool test, usually, or a colonoscopy. The people who are not getting screened tend to be people who don't go to the doctor very often, who don't have access to seeing a doctor, maybe not insurance, maybe undocumented, foreign-born, uninsured, so forth, or people who are reluctant to get screening because they're afraid of some of the things that you talked about in the opening about being afraid to get screening or being worried, maybe not educated well enough to be able to get over that barrier to go and get the screening that they need.
Mm-hmm. So you mentioned a couple of the tests. Maybe now would be a good time just to describe some of the tests that are available for people to do, because it's not just colonoscopy, as many people think.
Right. Now, in this country, the most common screening test to be completed is colonoscopy. Probably three-quarters of the screening that takes place or more is done with colonoscopy. And that's because it can be done once a year. Once every 10 years, excuse me. And you can order it, and you don't have to be screened again for 10 years. People mm-hmm. tend to like that. And it's also the most thorough in that you see the entire colon, and it gives a great deal of reassurance that you have nothing going on right now. So that's the most popular procedure that we have. However, many people, it's not without its risks. You can have a bowel perforation with it. You do have to go through this prep that you discussed. So there are potential complications. Some people just are very reluctant to get screening and with that test. So there are lots of other tests that you can get beforehand to determine really how high your risk for colorectal cancer is and determine whether you need to get a colonoscopy. The most common of those tests is an annual stool test. Mm-hmm. The best one of those is the fecal immunochemical test, which is usually a one or two sample stool test that you can take home from the doctor's office, complete within a day or two, and then just mail back into the laboratory. If that test comes back showing that you have a small amount of blood in your stool, mm-hmm. then you would go on for a colonoscopy.
Uh-huh. So is this becoming more of a standard, perhaps starting, maybe even starting earlier, with a stool test and only going to colonoscopy if there is a positive test returned?
It's a very common strategy. In fact, right now we don't really know whether all the evidence that we have suggests that doing annual stool tests with colonoscopy only if abnormal is probably, for most people, just as good a strategy as going straight to the colonoscopy. I think the problem is that many people maybe get one stool test and then think they're done, and they don't get one for several uh-huh. years, or they don't come into the doctor, they don't get reminded. So it takes a fair bit of work, even though it's much less invasive and much less expensive, to do annual stool testing, and much easier. You can do it in the privacy of your own home.
Yes.
One has to have a very robust program to bring the patient mm-hmm. the kit. So
Kaiser has a very good program at doing that. And Dr. Hyatt, do you know anything about that? I know you do research with Kaiser. Do you know
sure.
anything about that program?
Well, it's been a long-term program, actually. The research that I actually did when I was, or the research that was done, well, I should say, when I was there, established the importance of what was then sigmoidoscopy before we had colonoscopy.
Uh-huh.
But that caused a sort of a ground shift in focus for that organization, and they devoted a lot of attention to screening, both with the stool test and with endoscopy. And they've seen dramatic drops in their rates of new cancers as well as mortality. Uh-huh. So in many ways, what Kaiser Permanente has done is a model for the rest of us in moving this across the whole city and across the whole region.
Mm-hmm. So is San Francisco talking about implementing something like that model citywide?
Well, so this is what we're trying to do with SF-CAN. So this is one of the important cancers that we are working with, as I said before. And what we're trying to do is organize the organizations and providers in the city to work together to accomplish the goal of reducing colorectal cancer, in this case, across the whole population. What that takes is some communication and systematic information technology linkages between the different mm-hmm, organizations, mm-hmm. which is what we intend to do with SF-CAN. So it's not just mm-hmm. one organization working on their own population,
yes.
but realizing that the citizens of the region, in San Francisco in this case, move around. And so in order to keep track of who's been screened and who hasn't and where they're going, it takes more of a cross-the-city, in this case, organized approach.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's a great effort. If you're just joining us, you're listening to About Health. I'm Dr. Will Courtenay, your host. March is National Colon Cancer Awareness Month, and today we're discussing colon cancer and screening for the disease. And we're going to want to hear from you, so please give us a call. Our number is 510-848-4425. That's 510-848-4425. Toll free, the number is 1-800-958-9008. That's 1-800-958-9008. What was your experience like being screened for colon cancer? Or are you due to be screened but find yourself putting it off? Are you confused about the various screening tests and their effectiveness? We want to hear your questions and comments, so we'll be taking your calls shortly. Again, our numbers are 1-800-958-9008 or 510-848-4425. Mike Potter, you wanted to add something?
I just wanted to add the issue of we talked about the range of options that people have, and that where people have options for screening, they're likely to get it done. Now, in a lot of healthcare systems, colonoscopy is not as widely available. And so it really has to be reserved for the people who are high risk, who really need a colonoscopy, either because they have family history or risk factors, or because they have an abnormal stool test. And that's the case in a lot of our community health centers, which serve a large proportion of the Bay Area, as you know. Yeah. So in those settings, one of the things that we're doing in San Francisco, and I think across the Bay Area, people are trying to do the same thing, is really increase access to the annual stool test, the fecal immunochemical test, in those populations. And really with the emphasis on the idea that it's not a second-class test, it's an excellent test, as long as you do it every year. As long as it's followed up with colonoscopy if it's abnormal.
Yes.
And Bob? You were asking about disparities earlier, and Mike gave you some information on that. One of the things we know from our cancer registry data is the rates of colorectal cancer by race and ethnicity within the city and within the region. And one thing the listeners should know is that there are higher rates both of new cancers and of deaths in African-American populations.
Yes.
So black men and women are at higher risk of both getting colorectal cancer and dying from it. So I think special attention, education, and access issues are one way we're trying to reduce that disparity.
Yes. And they're also less likely to get screened.
That's one of the issues.
So we have a number of callers calling. So let's go to our first caller, Jackie. Jackie, welcome to About Health.
Oh, thank you.
So did you have a question or comment, Jackie?
I did. I actually have gone through a colonoscopy and the prep, and it was, as you described, it was horrendous. And I chose to go forward with the colonoscopy because I did understand that maybe it was better served in terms of screening. And I elected to do the procedure without any anesthetic because I understood that there would be less time in terms of the test itself. And I have to say it was something I probably wouldn't do again in without any anesthesia. And if I knew that the scan, the fecal occult blood test, or any of the other testing that's being spoken about today was just as appropriate in terms of screening, given that I don't have any background of colon cancer in my family or any polyps, I would elect to do this on a yearly basis to make certain that I was heading in the right direction. And again, if there was anything that was detected that would be perhaps suspicious, I would be open to then going forward with more invasive testing. But I will say that it was significant. I was in a significant amount of pain during the procedure, and the preparation was really difficult to get through.
So I'm so sorry to hear that, Jackie. And Dr. Yeah. Potter, you wanted to respond to Jackie?
Yeah, the PrEP can be pretty miserable for a lot of people. I think one way you can reduce the unpleasantness of the PrEP is to try not to eat too much for the day or two before, so that you don't have as much stuff to clear out. You could also talk to your doctor about different kinds of PrEPs, because not all of them are as onerous. I would never recommend anyone voluntarily going through a colonoscopy without some sort of sedation. There are different ways of doing that. Colonoscopies sometimes are done with anesthesia full anesthesia for people who have high risk factors, but usually it's done with sedation, which is an IV intravenous medication that just kind of puts you to sleep. And actually, I can say I had a colonoscopy about a year ago, and it was one of the most pleasant sleeps I've had in quite a while. So I didn't want them to wake me up.
Well, so, not at all like Jackie's experience.
So, yeah. So I think if you have to have the procedure again, definitely not for the sedation. But I also want to say, I think this is a really important point you bring up, Jackie, about the menu of options. It's really important for doctors and other providers, healthcare providers, to, before ordering a test, to ask, first of all, what are your risk factors for colon cancer, to find out, do you have a sibling or a parent who's had colon cancer? Do you is there any concern that you could have symptoms like rectal bleeding or abdominal pain, things that might signal that you really do need to have the colonoscopy, or ulcerative colitis or something like that? So important to find out if you really should have colonoscopy over everything else. If you're an average risk person between the ages of 50 and 75, I think it really is important for doctors to present, when they're available, the range of options, because many people do prefer a range of options. And in fact, there's even been research to show that when people are presented with a range of options for colorectal cancer screening, they're more likely to complete a test. And we often say in this field, the best test for colorectal cancer screening is the one that gets done. So,
right. So, and do we know anything about the percentage of doctors who are giving people that range? Because it seems like they go immediately to colonoscopy.
Yeah.
That's a lot of people's experience, at least, it seems.
Yeah, I think my experience working with the National Colorectal Cancer Roundtable and coming in contact with practitioners across the country is that most doctors have a bias towards colonoscopy. And primary care, I think it's partly because it's just easy to order. If a patient will get the test, we don't have to worry about it for 10 years.
And don't have to follow up.
And then if patients don't want to get the colonoscopy, if they're resistant, they may say, well, you can get this stool test. But I think that's really wrong. I think people should be offered the full range of tests that are available.
Yes.
And well, I might add, too, that I feel in terms of giving now the hall pass for 10 years that I don't have to follow up or have anything screened, I feel that it would be more appropriate for me to continue to have some sort of testing, and then I would lean forward more towards having these stool tests yearly, even now, even though I've gotten the hall pass, just to make certain that nothing has changed.
Well, in response to that question, I think that's another really important question. The 10-year screening interval for colonoscopy is really based on the idea that it takes, for most colon cancers, not all colon cancers, but for most, it takes many years to go from having a completely normal colon to developing a small polyp to developing a cancer that might actually be life-threatening, and that's the reason for the 10-year interval. So we don't actually think that if you had a really high-quality colonoscopy and you have no other risk factors, that you should need to worry about getting another colonoscopy for 10 years. That does not mean, however, that if you develop some bleeding or abdominal pain, or you find out something about your family history, suppose your sibling or your parent develops colon cancer, that doesn't mean you shouldn't you should not get screened under any circumstances for 10 years. But I want you to be assured, reasonably assured, that you probably don't have to worry that much about colon cancer for the next 10 years as a result of having had that procedure, if it was done well.
Especially with that. And I'm so glad, Jackie, you mentioned those two important words, family history. You know, when you don't have a family history like that, then there is, you know, less risk. So I thank you so much, Jackie, for calling in. I talked to your doctor about that stool sample test.
Agreed. Thanks for the great topic.
All right. Thank you. Let's go right to another caller, and let's speak to Greg in Palo Alto. Welcome to About Health, Greg.
Hello. Thank you. Just a couple of comments and a question. One is that I had an experience, unfortunately, similar to the experience of the previous caller. And what was disturbing to me was that the options weren't presented to me. I just, quick background, I'd lost a lot of weight over a fairly short period of time. So I went in to see my general practitioner. They referred me to the GI people. It was kind of surprising to me. This is retrospectively. I didn't realize this at the time. But they wanted to immediately go and do the colonoscopy and endoscopy and didn't offer a stool test to me at the time and didn't even ask me what I think are really fundamental questions that I don't think have come up here. And one is, like, what are you eating? I mean, what's your diet like? Do you have this history of colon cancer in your family? What kind of medications are you on? What's your lifestyle like that might lead to them assuming that this weight loss could be attributable to a cancer? So I went through that whole procedure, which was horrific. And then on top of that, they didn't find anything, so they wanted to do CAT scans. I was really reluctant because of the amount of radiation you get exposed to. But my doctor insisted that, you know, we want to rule this out, so we do that. So they did rule it out. I got two CAT scans, and that was done. And unfortunately, if I had to do that over again, I think I would have said that, hey, look, let's start out a different way here. I mean, not the first option is not a colonoscopy or the CAT scans. Let's go to something else. And I think what I heard so far is that the options are the stool test, and I think that makes sense. And I'm glad you brought this up because I need to do that. I'm wondering if other than a sigmoidoscopy, are there any other alternative approaches to this? And just your comments about my experience and about maybe new approaches to screening, if there are any.
Yeah, thanks. First of all, sounds like you had quite an ordeal. I'm glad you're feeling better now. But and it would be hard for me to second-guess your doctors about what the reason was that they decided that you should have all these tests. Of course, if you're losing weight and it's unexplained, that tends to make doctors pretty nervous and want to rule a lot of things out. I don't know. As I said, I don't know all the details of your case, but it does speak a lot to the importance of being able to have open communication with your physician and being able to have a discussion of your concerns and really having things explained to you as well as possible before you go ahead with a procedure that you might not really, really want to have.
Yeah, and Greg, you brought up another really important point about diet and exercise, and we haven't addressed that yet. And, you know, there's very good research demonstrating that the consumption of red meats and processed meats in particular increase the risk of colorectal cancer, and that fruits and vegetables lower the risk. Similarly, the being overweight increases the risk, and maintaining a healthy weight or exercising lowers that risk.
As does smoking also increases the risk somewhat.
So is there anything else in terms of what Greg is bringing up about sort of more prevention and other questions that we need to be thinking about?
Sure. Yeah, I'd be glad to talk about some of the other screening tests that are available. So we mentioned colonoscopy in great detail already, so that's one of the tests, and that is the sort of the final common pathway of all screening, because if any of the other tests are abnormal, you still have to have the colonoscopy. And then there's the stool testing, which is the one that we recommend for stool testing is the fecal immunochemical test, because it's very specific for human hemoglobin. It is it's sensitive and accurate compared to some of the other older versions of stool tests, the ones some of you may be familiar with, the Guaiac stool test, which was usually you'd have to do three samples after changing your diet for several days. And very hard for patients for people, anyone, to go through all those procedures and actually complete it and turn it in. And then it, on top of that, it's not quite as accurate. So for an annual stool test, we recommend the fecal immunochemical test. Now, there's a new test that combines a fecal immunochemical test with a stool DNA test. And that one, on a single application, is probably even more accurate than the fecal immunochemical test alone.
Mm-hmm. So that's the Cologuard test. That was a test I did myself this year.
Okay.
But I think you had said that we don't really know exactly whether that added DNA evidence we get from that really tells us much more.
Right. Well, we know that it's at least as accurate as a FIT test because it includes a FIT test in it.
Mm-hmm.
We don't know. We assume, since it's a little bit more accurate, it might be a little bit better if you did it every single year. The manufacturers have recommended doing it every 3 years.
Oh.
So we don't know whether that hasn't really been... It's sort of a theoretical thing that maybe because it's a little better, you can do it every 3 years. The other thing about it is that compared to fecal immunochemical testing alone, which is about a $10 test, the Cologuard is several hundred dollars.
Mm.
So it adds
mm-hmm.
significantly to the mm-hmm. cost of screening. And then finally, one of the things we also don't know is suppose you get a stool test and it says, well, you might have some DNA from a cancer that suggests you could have cancer. Then you go and you get a colonoscopy, and many times they don't see anything.
Uh-huh.
And so then what are you supposed to do? You're left with this test that says, well, maybe you have DNA that suggests you have colon cancer and no one can find it. It sort of can be very unsettling, and we're not sure whether that really, you know, with the false positives and so forth that you might get, how that's going to affect people. So most people are sticking with the annual stool test.
Uh-huh.
There's one other test that is also being used in some centers, and that's called, maybe some of you have heard of the term virtual colonoscopy. Have you ever heard of that?
No, I hadn't heard about that.
So that's a test. It's a radiology test. It's done in it's also called CT colonography. So you go through the same bowel prep as a colonoscopy.
Hmm.
And instead of having the tube put up your rectum, you have air blown in and you get a CT scan. Relatively low
dose
of radiation.
Hmm. Mm-hmm.
But that's a less invasive way to mm-hmm. get a 3D image of the colon.
Mm-hmm.
Then if that's abnormal, and about 20% of them are abnormal, then you can either, mm-hmm. in some mm-hmm. settings, they'll just roll you over into the colonoscopy suite and give mm-hmm. you a
uh-huh.
colonoscopy right thereafter.
Uh-huh.
Or you may have to go through another prep and get the colonoscopy. That also adds significantly to the costs of the procedure,
right.
potentially,
mm-hmm.
and there are a lot of questions about it. But in certain situations, some people who have access to it may choose that option.
Uh-huh. So it sounds like Greg probably wouldn't with his concerns about radiation. But Greg, I want to thank you so much for your call. I appreciate it. And Dr. Hiatt, you wanted to jump in too.
Yeah, I wanted to respond to, I think, one of Greg's points, and that was the issues around what we call lifestyle factors or diet and physical
mm-hmm.
activity.
Yes.
In particular, I think alcohol is also one of the other potential risk factors at a population level, as is smoking. So the way to think about this is these are all well-defined results from population or epidemiologic studies. We know that they're true. But the way to think about them as an individual is that these are good things for people to do for a number of reasons, not just colorectal cancer, but for other cancers
yes.
and for heart disease.
Right.
But they're not going to take the place of any one of these screening tests for reducing colorectal cancer. Mm. So I don't want your listeners to leave the program thinking,
uh-huh.
oh, if I just eat the right diet and run around the block three times and stop smoking, then I won't get colon cancer.
And don't have any symptoms.
Right.
So
this discussion is really about the benefits that we know exist for colorectal cancer screening and how to go about it.
That's a great point. I appreciate you mentioning that. If you're just tuning in, you're listening to About Health, and I'm Dr. Will Courtenay, your host. March is National Colon Cancer Awareness Month, and we're talking today about the cancer and screening for the disease. We'd love to hear your questions or comments. Have you put off having a necessary screening for colon cancer? If so, let us know why. And if you've been screened, which test did you use? Give us a call at 510-848-4425 or toll free at 1-800-958-9008. Joining me in studio are two doctors, physicians from UCSF, who are also associated with SFCAN, the San Francisco Cancer Initiative. Dr. Robert Hiatt is Associate Director of the UCSF Helen Diller Family Comprehensive Cancer Center and is co-leader of SFCAN. Dr. Michael Potter is a practicing physician and researcher at UCSF, and he co-leads the Colorectal Cancer Task Force for SFCAN. Again, if you have any questions about colon cancer, please give us a call at 510-848-4425 or toll free at 1-800-958-9008. Let's go again to another one of our callers, Paul in San Francisco. Paul, welcome to About Health.
Hi, this is Dr. Paul Katangas, and I'm wondering if you remember the name of the famous commentator on 60 Minutes, Rodney, what was his name? He used to be the commentator. He just died 2011 at age 90, and when he was getting ready to go around the world, he went in just to have a physical, and they said, oh, you've never been checked for your colon, see if you have colon cancer. And he said, yeah, I've never been checked. That's true. I don't do that kind of thing. They said, well, just to be safe, why don't we check you? And so they did, and the next day he was dead because the tube they inserted in his rectum punctured the lining, and he died from peritonitis. The question is, how many deaths occur in hospitals in the United States every year due to doctors' errors like that? The answer is about 100,000. And, another example, you mentioned black men suffer more injuries from this than white men. Another group black men suffer more from is autism. Four times as many black men get autism as white men. Why is that? There's a new movie out from Hollywood about called Vax that shows that the CDC has been covering this up for 10 years now.
Well, Dr. Paul, that we could probably assume that some of the reasons for that are similar to the reasons black men are not getting screened for colon cancer, and that those are structural issues, lack of insurance, and other problems like that. Now, in terms of the risks from colonoscopy, you want to address that, Dr.
Yeah, Karen? That is probably one of the reasons why a 90-year-old person should not be going in for some elective procedure that they may not need. That's one
right.
of the reasons why, actually, it's actually one of the reasons why colonoscopy is typically recommended to be stopped by 75 or perhaps a little later if you're really healthy and expect to live at least 7 to 10 more years. But you really shouldn't take that risk if you're not expecting to live for a good while afterwards.
If you identify the some polyps, he could be 100 before the cancer actually appears.
And there are some risks. Probably about 1 in 300 or 400 people who get a colonoscopy will have some sort of problem with a bleeding that may require them to be observed in the hospital briefly. There are bowel perforations. Bowel perforations are pretty uncommon. Very uncommon among, if the procedure's done correctly. But it is a risk, and that's one of the reasons why some people choose to have stool testing instead.
Mm-hmm.
But I would not use that as a reason not to get a colonoscopy in the case of an abnormal stool test,
yes.
in the case where you have a significant family history or risk factors. The benefits in those situations are clearly much greater than any risk.
Uh-huh. Well, thank you, Dr. Paul, for your call. And yes, of course, this was a first time. This was a first test. And again, we wouldn't, certainly at his age, you wouldn't go first to this test. Well, let's go to another caller. And we're going to speak to Leif in Berkeley. Leif, welcome to About Health.
Oh, hi. Thanks for taking my call.
You're welcome.
I have two questions. One is I'm 58. I've had Medi-Cal for 10 years. The clinics won't touch this issue.
Which issue is that?
About getting a cancer test. I had a guy who was very, very reluctant. I finally had the doctor for a couple years. I finally assisted. He did a swipe. And I don't know how it doesn't seem like that's adequate, but, and I never got any information back one way or the other. He was very reluctant. So my other question is, sorry, I may have three. I have a, the other question is I'm 58, 10 or 15 years ago, I had IBS. I don't anymore at all. I've had constipation as a result of a year and a half with no diagnosis. I have hemorrhoids. So are they, is that something that might be, and I don't have constipation anymore for 7 years, but are those things indicative of that I might have cancer or should be screened? And also the question I have... I have a proctologist. Is he someone I could go to? Because I don't trust Medi-Cal. And then the question is, yeah, so where could I get the stool test? I live in Berkeley. And then, I'm sorry, the third question is regarding information in the past and keeping people on schedule with their stool test. How come we just don't set up a website where people then get on the website and say, this is what I had with this doctor, and then you coordinate that on a website. Why does it take...
Well, increasingly, Leif, that is, I think, the direction that we're going, that with electronic charting, and we're going to be able to see much more of that. But you raised some really important questions. And, I mean, I think just the question, I'm sure that there are other listeners out there that are wondering, okay, because I have constipation or IBS, which is irritable bowel syndrome, is there some connection with colon cancer? So these are helpful for, I think, our listeners to hear.
Yeah, I mean, those are labels for diseases or for conditions. It's hard to know how they were actually diagnosed in your case. I think the things that would be the most concerning to me is if you're having persistent bleeding and it's not clear where the blood's coming from, that would seem to me to warrant a colonoscopy in that situation.
So you might have had bleeding from the hemorrhoids. But this is different than, and you got that taken care of, you said.
Right. If your hemorrhoids have been...
not happening anymore. Mm-hmm. So I still have the problem still in some respects once
right.
in a while.
So if the hemorrhoids were taken care of and you're not having any more bleeding, that's reassuring, I suppose.
Mm-hmm.
But in terms of... There are stool tests that sometimes are done in the office on a rectal exam. We don't really recommend that. It's not a very accurate. It's not how the tests were designed to be used. So we really recommend a home test. And I think if you are,
how do I get a home test?
Yeah. So you should. Do you? I hesitate to ask what clinic you're seeing, but you're in Berkeley and you're on Medi-Cal. There are several clinics in Berkeley that you could go to. One of them, one of the good ones, is Lifelong Medical Care. I don't know if that's an option for you, but these are not nonprofit medical health centers, clinics.
I'm sorry.
And
my experience with them is they have no follow-up, and I virtually have no doctor, and I just have interns, and I go round and round and round and round with them.
Well, I think
I had hemorrhoids for a year and a half. I even ended up at Alta Bates, and they still couldn't diagnose me.
Yeah.
And I happened to run a surgeon from one of my clients is a surgeon from UCSF, He had had a stroke. We were talking personally, and he said, "Oh, my friend's a proctologist, and he's the best doctor I've ever had in my life, and he happens to take Medi-Cal." And that's all I had to do is send me to a proctologist, but I went for a year and a half, and, and it got really serious.
I think if you went into your doctor's office and said, "I'm interested in colorectal cancer screening, I want a home stool test, please give me one." I don't know of too many clinics that would be saying, "I refuse to give one to you," because it's a very easy, inexpensive test. And if you are going to a place where they refuse to do that, I would go somewhere else.
Yeah. So and be it sounds like you were fairly insistent, Leif, and you're going to need to continue to do that. So I want to thank you very much for your call, Leif, and we want to go to some other callers. We have Cork in Mountain View. Cork, welcome to About Health.
Oh, thanks a lot. And it's Clark.
Oh, Clark. I'm sorry,
yeah.
Clark.
Really appreciate the show. I have a question. Before I do, I just want to say I had my first colonoscopy. It went down great, experienced the people, everything, and came out clean. So there's been a lot of negative talk about colonoscopy on the show, but I'll be one person to say that I was very happy I did it.
Oh, congratulations.
Well, I'm glad to hear that, and I'm glad you told us that. Do you have a question? Or?
Yes, I do. I want to ask, actually two in the brief, but I'd like to ask if impacted fecal matter is a risk factor that's associated with colon cancer. That's question number one. And question number two is the American Gut Project involved in colon cancer research?
Okay.
So impacted fecal matter is not really a risk for colorectal cancer that I know of, and I'm not familiar with this project, so maybe you can tell us a little bit about it.
Well, back to the impacted fecal matter, is it a real thing? I mean, there's all these stories of cadavers from Korea having 40-pound colons. Is impacted fecal matter a real thing at all that you know of?
Well, we can see that in people who take a lot of medications that are constipated, people, especially the elderly, people who are bedbound, who don't, you know, have the urge to have a bowel movement, they can get impacted and it can become a medical emergency sometimes, but often they'll show up in the emergency department and need to be hospitalized. We, you know, try to disimpact them in the emergency department. Sometimes they have to be observed in the hospital for a few days. Sometimes surgery is needed. So it is a real thing.
It's not very common.
I mean, it's common enough if you look in nursing home populations, for example.
Especially. But not associated with colon cancer.
Yeah.
Okay, great. All right, I'll tell you about the Gut Project then.
Clark, we actually have we have a number of other callers we're going to want to get to. Maybe we'll check on the Gut Project ourselves. Anyone else interested? I'm sure we can Google that.
Thank you guys a lot.
Well, thank you, Clark. I'm glad you had a good experience, too. All right, bye-bye. Let's go on to Gordon in Modesto.
Hi there.
Hi, Gordon.
Oh, okay, hi.
Welcome to About Health.
I just have to observe quickly. It's very unusual to have a program these days on KPFA where all the callers and all the people on the air are men. I guess that's because you said that it's more common... you know, it's a bigger problem to get men to get the screening. Maybe that's why. But anyway,
it's a great point, Gordon. My specialty is working with men, and you're right. There's been a lot of men on the program, and it's I'm really glad that we're actually reaching these men because it's so important. Yeah. They are more reluctant and they're less likely to be screened.
That's not what you called about.
Mm-hmm.
No. So I've been puzzling. And it really do me puzzling at the fact that you haven't discussed, supposedly there's a new blood screening test for colon cancer. Now, this went around in the news a couple of weeks ago. And so I was expecting to hear you talking about that.
So,
and it hasn't come up at all yet. And so while I was waiting, I just say quickly, I Googled online, of course. And the only and I'm puzzled that I didn't turn up anything in that was reported in the last couple of weeks. Maybe you know the answer to that. The only thing I did find was this is in the it's at health.harvard.edu from July of last year, and there was a new test approved by the FDA
which they say is somewhat less exact than other tests.
So well, thank you. Thank you, Gordon. Thanks for the call. And I'll, Dr. Potter was nodding his head over here, so I'm going to let him take that on.
So wouldn't it be great if we had a blood test that could diagnose colorectal cancer? It would make things so much easier for everyone. Mm-hmm. It really is sort of the holy grail, if I'm permitted to say that, for colon cancer screening. And there are some products that are being developed that may have some promise. And there are even that maybe have been approved by the FDA, the Food and Drug Administration. I would want to say that tests that are approved by the FDA does not necessarily have to undergo such a stringent vetting and testing as one might expect before major guideline organizations start endorsing it. So I would say those products are under development and they're not really ready to be recommended because they haven't really been tested head-to-head against the other methods that we have yet.
Well, again, Gordon, thanks for your call. And we've got other callers waiting, so I want to go to them, Hank and Hayward. And, Hank, we're getting near to the end of our program and have other callers waiting.
Sure. This is real quick. It's really regarding a couple of things, comments, and then a question. One is relative to socioeconomical class. I think it's real clear that low income particularly is a factor in neglecting health care, so that's a factor that African American men.
Yes.
Secondly, I think that financially it seems to be more rewarding for physicians to do colonoscopies as opposed to the stool test. I've gone to a couple of doctors and no one's never mentioned to me about a stool test, so I'm thinking it's a financially fee-for-service much lower and less likely, and that's really pathetic and sad because if I'd known about this, I probably would have gotten the stool test a long time ago. So that needs to be really some kind of protocol in place to make sure that doesn't happen. Last factor here is you didn't talk about stress, and I just tend to believe that socioeconomically stress-related or not, I think stress is the underlying cause of so many diseases, and I'm clearly want to think that diet and stress combined together, poor diet and stress together, would be a factor. Lastly, and last comment, why isn't it done something in relationship to once you know you have colon cancer to begin to do something about the liver? Because it seems like once it spreads, gets to the liver, you're done. If you can prevent that spread, it seems like your chances are better because liver, mainly when it's damaged, is pretty much really over. That's my comments and questions.
Great. So, Hank, thank you so much. These are all really important points. Let's go to Bob Hiatt.
Yeah, thanks, Hank. There are good points. And socioeconomic status, stress, access issues are all much on our mind. Socioeconomic status is important not only for access to colorectal cancer screening, but for all the other types of prevention that we talked about. And part of the reason why we see higher rates in African Americans might be related to socioeconomic status issues. What socioeconomic status means is frequently less access to high quality care. It could mean less education about the benefits of screening. And it could, in fact, mean more exposure to stress. Now, what does stress do? Stress can have direct effects, but it also can mean that it affects your ability to think clearly about your health. So you're distracted by other more pressing issues, perhaps. So those are two very important pieces. I forget actually the third thing.
Well, and just on that point, it makes this follow up and with the stool testing. I mean, it really does require annual testing, and that becomes challenging if we're talking about people who are living in stressful situations. Some people living on the street, of course, that would become very difficult.
Okay. So that was the other thing. I think we've had a good discussion about the options, and as my colleague Dr. Potter has said, if you go into almost any medical care setting and ask for a stool test kit that you can take home, it's highly unlikely that anybody is going to refuse that to you. So that could get you into the right kind of care. Again, it's related to doctors and providers, you know, discussing the options with you.
So I was just going to address the issue of the liver. The liver is the place where the colon cancer tends to spread after it's passed through the colon and through the lymph nodes in that area. So that's what colon cancer screening can prevent, the need for worrying about that. So if you get the polyps before the cancer develops, if you get the cancer when it's at an early stage, you won't have to worry about the liver. But as part of the staging process, usually there is some evaluation of the liver to make sure that there isn't cancer there as well. What's really remarkable nowadays is that treatment for colorectal cancer, you can actually treat the colon and rectal cancer even after it's in the liver with surgery and with chemotherapy, and the outcomes are much better than they used to be. So mm-hmm. even if you're past the first stage of colorectal cancer, the treatments have really improved over the last few years.
Mm-hmm. So in terms of that, we were talking before the show about this one issue about people not wanting to find out that they have cancer. This is a major reason why people don't get screened, because, and it sort of presents a dilemma, I think, for public health advocates who say, you know, get screened and get detected early so we can find the cancer early. And these people are saying, I don't want to know that I have cancer. So what do you say to
that? Yeah, colorectal cancer is mostly preventable, mostly curable when found early. And I think there's one other reason that's really important for people, is that we're in the stage where there's health reform. We call it supposed reform. And so those of you who can get screened and are worrying about losing your insurance, get screened now, because that's going to be potentially life-saving down the line.
Uh-huh. Well, you know, I'm afraid we've reached the end of the show, and I'm so sorry we weren't able to get to all of our calls today. Dr. Bob Hiatt, for listeners who would like more information about your research or SF CAN, where can they find that?
Yeah, so there's a lot online. There's if you just Google SF CAN, you'll find something, but if you go to sfcancer.org, you can find out more about this initiative, and not only colorectal cancer screening, but what we can do to prevent all the major cancers.
Oh, great.
And I would add, the American Cancer Society is a great source of information for patients. And for those of you wanting to get involved in advocacy, the American Cancer Society is another great location for that, as well as you can check out the National Colorectal Cancer Roundtable website, which is nccrt.org. And there are a lot of resources for practitioners and for health systems at that website.
The American Cancer Society's motto for this is 80% by 18. Uh-huh. So we're shooting for 80% coverage of colorectal cancer screening by 2018, as Mike mentioned.
Great goal. Well, Dr. Hiatt and Dr. Potter, I want to thank you both very much for joining us today. This is such an important topic, and I wish you the very best with SF CAN. I also want to thank you, our listeners, for joining us, and especially those of you who phoned in. And thanks to our board operator, Erica Bridgman. If you missed any of today's program, or you'd like to listen to past shows, you can find them and the podcasts at kpfa.org on the About Health page. And if you have any suggestions for future shows or guests you'd like to hear on About Health, please contact me at drwill@themensdoc.com. If you'd like to learn more about me or my psychotherapy services, you can reach me at my website, themensdoc.com. That's themensdoc.com. I'd love to hear from you. From all of us at About Health, we wish you very good health.
Are you tired of The Matrix?
The movie?
No, not the movie, but the one you're living in. If so, then hang out with your friends at The Full Circle.
What's The Full Circle?
Full Circle is a radio show written, produced, and directed by apprentices right here at KPFA. We'll bring you everything from the obscure to the obvious, the hidden and the blatant, as well as all things in between. So be informed. Hear about your world community every Friday night from 7 to 8 p.m. on 94.1 FM, where we'll serve you the red pill with love.
Become a KPFA ally, a sustaining partner, the lifeblood of our station. At $10 or more a month, your gift goes further by providing KPFA with a stable source of income to support the programming you value. It's easy, and it provides a tax deduction. Plus, it helps us reduce the amount of time needed for on-air fund drives. To become an ally, go to kpfa.org and click support. Thank you.
Do you know what Area 941 is? It's KPFA.org's new podcasting space. This allows us to expand our programming with more on-demand programs so you can listen when you want or download them at any time. Area 941 is just another reason why people say, I heard it on KPFA.